So good afternoon, everyone. I am Gerard Atching, Director of Africana. And we are very honored and pleased to welcome Dr. Hakim Adi to Africana and to Cornell. Thanks in large part to the History Department's Hollenberg Guest Speakers Program, which affords undergraduates the opportunity to engage with top scholars. We have been able to extend an invitation for Dr. Adi to speak to us today about his research. Dr. Hakim Adi is a professor of history at the University of Chichester in the UK. He is the author of West Africans in Britain, 1900 to 1960, Nationalism, Pan-Africanism, and Communism, which came out in 1998 with Lawrence and Bouchard. With Marika Sherwood, he co-authored the 1945 Manchester Pan-African Congress we visited, which New Beacon published in 1995. In 2003, he published Pan-African History, Political Figures from Africa and the Diaspora since 1787 with Routledge. Also with Routledge, he co-authored Belonging in Europe, The African Diaspora and Work with Carolyn Bressy, which just came out in 2010. Dr. Adi has also authored three history books for children, including The History of the African and Caribbean Communities in Britain, which was published for the third time last year. Dr. Adi's most recent book, Pan-Africanism and Communism, The Communist International, Africa and the Diaspora, 1919 to 1939, was published by Africa World Press 2 years ago. It is the fruit of approximately 10 years of research in Britain, France, at the Comintern Archives in Moscow, Nigeria, and even elsewhere. There is a consensus among scholars that Dr. Adi's detailed research on the International Trade Union Committee of Negro Workers is important, enlightening, and seminal. We are very fortunate to have him with us today to discuss his book, or perhaps if tempted to speak about the book that he is currently working on, which is on the origin and evolution of Pan-Africanism. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Hakim Adi.
Central themes and ideas. Some of you may not be familiar I'm going to just say something about the kind of historical context and some of the things that I tried to do in the book, and just talk about some of the history, and then if there are questions or discussion, go into things in a little bit more detail. The first question I'm usually asked is what led me to write this book, why I was interested in it, and this book by Harry Haywood is one of the part of the inspiration, you could say, for writing it. I read that Bolshevik a very long time ago, probably soon after it was published in the mid-1970s, and I anticipated there might be some people here who had never heard of Harry Haywood or Black Bolshevik, and so I thought that for that reason as well I would mention it. It's an amazing autobiography, which obviously covers a period of his life and activism from the 1920s onwards. It was particularly interesting for me, I think, as a person coming into contact with political issues and ideas, that here was kind of unusual in the sense of not only as an autobiography of a key activist, but as an autobiography of a black communist, certainly at that time, and even since, there are not too many of those. It obviously touches on some of the history which I'm interested in Pan-Africanism and communism, because Haywood was in Moscow for periods, obviously active in the US, Spain, and elsewhere. And he touches on, mentions some of the personalities in the center of my book, but doesn't really go into very much detail. So his book, in a way, prompted me to look further into this whole relationship between activists from Africa, the African diaspora, and their connections with communism. The second book I could say that was kind of influential is George Padmore's famous Pan-Africanism and Communism, which was written at the height of the Cold War in the 1950s, and in a period when he had parted company with the communist movement. What is most significant about it in relation to my book is the fact that Padmore writes himself out of history. And so his early period as a communist, all the things that he stood for, are essentially written out of this seminal text. And that also kind of prompted me to look into these issues and this history in a bit more detail. And then the third reason is that in nearly all the research that I conducted, certainly West Africans in Britain, work on Manchester, and other work which looks at this first 60 years of the 20th century, everything connected either with Pan-Africanism or with anti-colonialism, which is in essentially the two areas that I work on. The issue of communism and communists is kept something which couldn't be avoided, even if I wished to avoid it. And I couldn't understand why there wasn't more literature on the subject. Of course, there's some things published on focusing on the US, and more recent years, a few things focusing on South Africa, but a more global Africa or Pan-Africa focus was missing. And so that also prompted into the subject. Okay. The other thing which is kind of interesting and worth bearing in mind is that the if we kind of think about many of the key figures in key Pan-African figures, those connected with the Pan-African movement throughout the 20th century, nearly all of them, or very many of them, had a connection with the communist movement. And so obviously Du Bois is an obvious example. It took him a long time to finally join the Communist Party, but as early as 1926 he visited the Soviet Union. When he returned he said, "This is Bolshevism, I'm Bolshevik." Practice, but anyway, it's a clear connection. Similarly, a figure like Paul Robeson, obviously his affiliation, sentiment, convictions are perhaps well known. Or a figure like Claudia Jones. I mentioned Claudia Jones, obviously she's well known to be here because of Carol's work. But I usually show this slide because Britain, where she's also extremely well known, but one of the characteristics of the way she's known is as anything but a communist. So she's connected with nothing but carnivores, she's seen as an activist, and she's on a postage stamp. Everybody has some knowledge of Claudia Jones, but the idea of Claudia Jones being a communist, people are less familiar with. Less happy with, of course, that's precisely what she was. This picture kind of gives it away, because she's reading from Lynn Foster's Papers for a Worker's Life, something just to make a point. Then we have, we look at the history of negritude, we have a figure like Emmy Césaire, again, very closely connected. Communist deputy for many years. Kwame Nkrumah, apart from his connections with the British Communist movement, again at the end of his life he confirmed his adherence to and with scientific socialism, another word for the ideas and theories of communism and so on. Then we have Brown, one could go on, these are just examples, again closely connected with the communist movement in Portugal in his early life, and there are other later connections as well. Then the last one, Nelson Mandela, some people had to wait until he died before there was a recognition that he was communist. So this connection between Pan-Africanism, say shouldn't be self-evident, but for various reasons there's a apparent separation, some might even say antagonism, which is perhaps reinforced by Padmore's writing. And the problem with the difficulty that comes from Padmore's writing is that what he said tends to be repeated by historians, other commentators and so on, as if everything he said was highly reliable, factual, and so on, which is very far from the case. So, how do we then explain this connection between communism, the communist movement, Africa, and the diaspora? Well, I suppose one very obvious start is the influence which the Russian Revolution of 1917 had on Africans. And in the book I quote from some of them who were overjoyed by the fact and consequence of that revolution, and hoped and prayed almost that Bolshevism would spread throughout the world as soon as possible. Because they instantly recognized that it was in contradiction with that thing which they lived in, not that system which was the source of their oppression. So that was one reason for early interest and support in many cases. Then there was the I suppose the orientation of the Communist International itself, which was established in 1919, as you probably know, international organization of Communist parties founded by Lenin. And from its inception, it not only preached the, let's say, brotherhood of humanity, to put it in the terms of the times, which is illustrated in this poster, but for the first time recognized the importance of the struggles of those in the colonial countries, in Africa, Asia in particular, as being, you could say, of equal importance and perhaps even greater significance than the struggles of the workers of Europe, the US, and other industrial countries. So the sympathy and support which the communist movement gave to those in Africa, the Caribbean, it was not just a question of kind of solidarity or brotherhood, its own racism and so on, which was also a feature of the communist movement, which many people admired and so on. That was a key political question. Now, the anti-colonial revolution was a key part of the opposition to global capitalism. So it was vital for the communist movement that those in the colonies and those elsewhere suffering as a consequence of colonial exploitation or racial oppression were united with workers of Europe and the US and so on. So these are important considerations when we think about the links between Pan-Africanism and communism. I skirted over two slides, because it's often useful to give just basic definitions to explain what I mean by these terms. So this is my shorthand definition of Pan-Africanism. And this is my shorthand definition of communism. Communism is a condition, or we can say sometimes it's the doctrine of connected with that condition. That is essentially what I'm talking about. So one can see from those definitions a clear connection between these two movements. Okay. And in the early period of the 1920s, early 1930s, as you're aware, many of those from Africa or the diaspora actually traveled to the Soviet Union. There's some travels of Paul Robeson, well known, I mentioned the boys. Another interested visitor was Langston Hughes. And if you read his autobiographical account again, he gives a very vivid illustration of what it meant to be somebody of African heritage traveling throughout the Soviet Union, particularly Central Asia. What he witnessed about the equality of nations, lack of racism, and so on, which was something which was mentioned by many, and was actually widely seen as a feature of this new socialist society that was being constructed. Even George Padmore, long after he parted company with the communist movement in 1945, wrote his very interesting book. How Russia Transformed Its Colonial Empire, which looks at this whole question in very much detail. So Langston Hughes talks about how those who were formerly oppressed nations and nationalities in the Soviet Union are now experiencing equality. So it's a very interesting book, but it illustrates this significance of communism and the Soviet Union for many people of African heritage throughout the world. And of course, in the US, there were many early adherents. The African Blood Brotherhood were one of the most well known of those who established organizational links with the Communist Party. African Brotherhood emerged after the First World War, led by Cyril Briggs from the Caribbean, and many of its other leading members were of Caribbean origin. It's an interesting organization, but it's, I mean, its key significance is that it, I guess in a way it was a successor to those like Hubert Harrison and others who had been organizing it before the war, in that it campaigned kind of ideas of race first, of Pan-African concerns, the liberation of Negroes everywhere and so on, with a commitment to socialism and to socialist revolution. And many of its members, including Cyril Briggs, very soon joined the communist movement. And they took many of their ideas with them. And this kind of Pan-African outlook on things became important in the communist movement, not just in the US, but internationally. And here we have one of the most famous of the members of the African Brotherhood, the Jamaican poet, Claude McKay, of the Fourth Congress of the Communist International in 1922. And what's interesting about McKay's visit, I won't go into all of the features of it, was that he implored the communist movement to step up their activity amongst Negroes. He said, this is what we need. We have to have more Negroes in the communist movement. We're kind of waiting to be recruited and so on and so forth. And again, just an illustration of the connection between those who consider themselves Pan-Africanism, one sort or another, in this early period with the communist movement. At this Congress, the Communist International established a, we can say, it kind of crystallized its, what I've called its Pan-Africanist policy. That is to say, it developed a policy on Negro question, meaning the liberation of Africans worldwide. And this question was first discussed in the Communist International at the request of Lenin, and by 1922 it had been discussed for some years. At this Congress, a policy was established that the Communist International would take up this question of organizing and recruiting among Africans globally. And of course, the interesting thing is that there was a recognition that this was an interrelated, interconnected question, even though the conditions facing people in the US, Jamaica, Nigeria, South Africa, Britain might be different, yet this was one related Negro question. And this became the policy of the Communist International throughout this period, well until the outbreak of the Second World War, which is a period covered by the war. The other representative from the US in that Congress was Otto Griswold, or Griswood, you see a picture of McKay here, who was a communist from Suriname, one of the founders of the communist movement in the US, and a key figure internationally from this period on. So he actually chaired the Commission on the Negro Question at that Congress. Okay, well, I've had a little bit of concentration there on the US, and it's worth pointing out that many of the key figures in the international communist movement in connection with this question did emanate from the US party. Obviously, there were large numbers of African American and others of African origin in that party. And there was a thinking at that time, which wasn't in any way different from the thinking of others in the wider Pan-African movement, that those in the US were kind of destined to lead everything. Some people still think that today. Anyway, certainly it was a consideration at that time, and it found its echo within the communist movement. So, however, it was a global movement, so I just want to say a little bit about France. And in France is interesting because if you look at all of the early congresses, French Communist Party was one of the parties singled out for particular criticism because it wasn't doing enough to take up this question about this African and Caribbean population, its colonies and so on. The British Party was similarly criticized. In fact, all the major parties were criticized in this way. But there were actually very interesting developments in France in the early 1920s. This is the meeting organized, as you can see, by the Union Internationale de Colonial, which, as its name suggests, was a union of activists from French colonies, Africa, the Caribbean, Indochina, and elsewhere. What is interesting about this union is that it soon there was a split in it. It was a union connected with the Communist Party, I won't put it any more precisely than that. But its African and Caribbean members split away from the union and formed their own, you can say, Pan-African organization, which similarly was connected with the Communist Party in the mid-1920s. And the leader of that organization, that breakaway, was this gentleman here, Lamine Senghor, who was an ex-combatant, had participated in the First World War, been gassed, wounded, decorated, found himself in Paris where he joined the Communist Party, stood as a candidate in the Parisian elections in 1925, and became the leader of this organization. Comité de Défense de la Race Nègre, which in 1927 published its paper, which you can see here, White Nègre. And you'll notice that it has in the title not the words noir or some other word, but the word nègre. And this first edition of the paper actually explains why that word is used. And the main reasons given are that it's like a kind of reclamation of that the word black was reclaimed in the 1960s. So the idea was that the communists, black communists, that they were reclaiming this word. And they also said that those rather bourgeois individuals certainly wouldn't want to be associated with any organization that had the word negro at this time. But that was another good reason. So naming themselves. So this organization flourished in France in the late 1920s. Lamine Senghor went on to be a key, you could say, international figure. Here we see him and other delegates at the founding Congress of the League Against Imperialism in Brussels in 1927, a Congress organized by the Communist International, organized clandestinely, we would say, though probably most people knew who organized it. It was a gathering of anti-colonial forces internationally, and a significant congress in its own right. But from my point of view, it was interesting because those close to the communist movement organized their own Negro Commission, which had representatives from France, from the US, from Africa. Here we see some of the members of that commission. And again, what was important here is we have this Pan-African gathering in the midst of a general anti-colonial congress and the communists and their supporters again working out a policy, if you like, which would elaborate on those already developed, again on this global Negro question, or Pan-African question. The Comintern itself then further developed its own role at the end of the 1920s with the establishment of this committee, the International Trade Union Committee of Negro Workers, which I explain in some detail in the book. it was partly established as a means of monitoring the activities of communist parties who many felt were not doing their job. So as I said before, there were many criticisms of British, French, US, South African and other parties that had a particular responsibility for the liberation of Africa and Africans. And the criticism very often from black communists as well as from others was that they weren't doing enough. So this organization was set up in order to monitor them, to assist them, to influence them and so on. And in general, it was led by black communists. Not everybody connected with it was African or African heritage, but most of its leadership generally was. And that was first established in 1928 with its own program. Again, not to necessarily organize on its own, but to assist the communist movement internationally to organize. It had a monthly publication produced in French and in English. This is the French edition. And in 1930, it organized its own Pan-African conference, which it was sometimes referred to in privately in that way. It was held in Hamburg, as you can see. And is, in my mind, a kind of forgotten Pan-African. Quite a significant one, even though the numbers of attendees were quite small. You can see some of the delegates. There were all kinds of problems to get people there. A delegation came from the US and held up because of the racism of the shipping lines. Other people who tried to get them were arrested. There were all kinds of difficulties. And the conference was held in Hamburg because it couldn't be held in London. Switch at the last minute and so on. But even so, a significant event, which maybe I'll come back to and say more about a little later. The International Trade Union Committee of Negro Workers was first headed by the gentleman on the left here. This is James Ford, a well-known African-American communist who stood as vice presidential candidate party throughout the 1930s. The gentleman on the right is Gaon Kouyaté, who was the successor of Lamin Senghor as the leading communist, black communist in France. The second secretary of the International Trade Union Committee was George Padmore, also a representative of the member of the American Communist Party, Trinidadian in origin, who had joined the Communist Party in the mid-1920s. One interesting feature of the leading figures in the international movement, talking now of those of African origin, was their rapid rise to prominence. So you could join the Communist Party 1 year, 3 years later, 4 years later, all kinds of responsibilities, influence, and so on. And this was certainly the case with Padmore and Ford as well. Ford was also an ex-combatant. Both of them were stationed in Hamburg, where the committee established its secretariat. Both worked in very, very difficult conditions, almost alone. Padmore had one of his wives with him. Gentleman had many wives. This particular wife was an Austrian woman called Frieda Schiff. I don't know anyone that actually ever written about Frieda Schiff, very, very interesting. Anyway, she played a very important role in his work during the 2 or so years he was based in Europe. But from an archival point of view, there's almost nothing about her at all. So there's a great PhD for something in the future. Padmore was a very active organizer, even though, as I said, the role of the secretary was quite a difficult secretary was responsible for producing Negro worker, liaising with people internationally. Of course, Hamburg was important in that regard because it was a major port, and so these were days before email, Twitter, and so on and so forth. And so communication was by sea, and therefore mariners were particularly important couriers of propaganda, or information, or letters, or and so on and so forth. Padmore also produced this very interesting book, The Life and Struggle of Negro Toilers, which again was a global, gave a global analysis of the problems confronting African workers, whether in the continent or in the diaspora. Interestingly, if you look at his Pan-Africanism or Communism in the 1950s, the first few editions list The Life and Struggle of Negro Toilers as one of his publications. In the later editions, it suddenly disappears. As if, again, this early part of his life has been erased from history. The third secretary of the Trade Union Committee was Otto Griswold and his wife Amina, who was from what is today Guyana. I should explain that, I'm not going to go into detail here, that Padmore was expelled from, or resigned from, or both, the communist movement in 1934. And his place was taken by Griswold's wife, who based themselves first in Holland, then in Belgium, and finally in Paris. They were arrested and deported in both countries. It obviously was extremely hazardous occupation. Padmore himself was arrested in Germany when the Nazis came to power and deported to Britain, along with a big cache of documents and secret information, which he claimed had been well hidden. But clearly wasn't, because the Gestapo handed it over to the security services in Britain. I would explain that the communist movement had a general policy on this so-called Negro question, but of course there was a specific positions on individual countries, and perhaps the most well known is the position that was adopted in relation to the US, the so-called Black Belt thesis. You're probably familiar with, so I won't go into it now. But this is an illustration of that position developed about 1930. The communist movement internationally took up a number of key issues and campaigns. One of the most significant, as far as African diaspora was concerned, was the Scottsboro case, which again we'll be familiar with, so I'll explain it in more detail now. And one of the leading figures in organizing the whole Scotsboro campaign was William Paterson, you see illustrated here. And Paterson was also one of the early organizers of the International Trade Union Committee. He was very active in Britain and in France. In fact, he played a very interesting role in Britain, which I won't go into now. So a key figure throughout this whole period in Europe and the Soviet Union, all over the place. The Scottsboro case became international, and the mother of two of the accused, Ada Wright, traveled around the world. Here she's pictured in Scotland, but she also visited France, Germany, and other European countries, including the Soviet Union. So it was a big international campaign. It had a significant impact, as I'm sure Carol has said several times, on Lloyd Jones, on various other people who were attracted to the communist movement by the stand it took defending these nine falsely accused African American youth. The communist movement had great difficulties organizing in Africa, certainly in people refer to sub-Saharan Africa, there was only one communist party, the Communist Party of South Africa, which had its own difficulties and complexities that I won't go into in detail. But it started off as a party of, which was largely a party of communists of European origin, and the Comintern stepped in to change that situation. And we see it reflected here in the title of the publication of that party, which changed its name from South African Worker to the early 1930s. It was anyway, quite an important party, as you know, it's still around today, one of the longest existing Communist Party, and certainly that's the case in Africa. You also see this phrase, Maibuyi, which people may be familiar with from the period of the active apartheid struggle. So a slogan that goes back to this period of the 1920s, and it's associated not only in general with the struggle against the racist regime of that period, but also connected with the communist movement. And the communists even had a song developed around this slogan. And this is one of the key communists in South Africa, that man called Johnny Gomez, who was extremely active, organizer from Cape Town, imprisoned on many occasions. Okay, well, I thought I would just give an illustration of some of those involved internationally. So here we have Francois, one of the leaders, perhaps the principal leader of the workers' movement in Trinidad in the 1930s, originally from St. Vincent. She had the distinction, I think, of being the first woman to be charged with sedition. Political, potentially communist activities. A law dress, I believe, by profession. Here we have another of the eminent communists of the 1930s. I'm sure you're familiar with it, Jacques Roman, the famous Haitian poet and the founder of the Communist Party of Haiti. And another famous individual, Isaac Wallace Johnson, who I don't think I would call him a communist. He was educated in Moscow, was a major activist for the communist movement, organizer in West Africa, particularly in Sierra Leone, but also in Gold Coast, Nigeria during this period, and worked both with Padmore, Greasewood, and others. Then we have, anyway, just to give again an illustration of the difficulties of organizing. This is André Alica, who was a leading communist in Martinique, the editor of the paper Justice, who was assassinated, as you can see from this leaflet in 1934. And there was a major campaign. This is actually produced in France by his comrades in France to try and bring to justice his killers. Had done successfully, nobody knew who had been responsible for the murder. In fact, as you can see there, it was not the first time there was an attempt to assassinate him. So being a communist could be quite hazardous in that period, as in any period. Okay. So another course select of this period was the fascist invasion of Ethiopia. And the communist movement, and particularly the black communists, we can say, played a very significant role in organizing an opposition to that invasion. In the book, I go into this in great detail because there's some controversy about the role of the Soviet Union. George Padmore wrote on sorts of things. So I've gone into it in some detail, which I probably didn't know. But this is an interesting picture which kind of illustrates this these dual concerns, if you like. On the one hand, the, you can perhaps say, the Pan-African concerns of those who were indignant about and opposed to the invasion of Ethiopia, and on the other, the demands of the communist movement for collective security, in general opposition to fascism and the danger of a new world war, which was ever present in the late 1930s. So they're both captured in this photo, which is taken in Wales and Cardiff in the late 1930s. And again, all of those in this picture would be communists or close to the communist movement during that period. And it's worth mentioning that several international conferences were organized, including conferences of Africans and Arabs, thinking now particularly those organized in Paris against this invasion. So it was a very, very big deal for the communist movement. Okay, so what is the significance of all of this? Well, it's important perhaps in its own right as something that is has been rather marginalized perhaps. And as I say, this link between Pan-Africanism and communism perhaps slightly written out of history. But I think it did have some rather interesting consequences. This year we celebrate the 70th anniversary of the Manchester Pan-African Congress, as you can see illustrated here. The Manchester Congress was largely organized by George Patton. Of course, it included some of those he worked with in the 1930s, like Isaac Morris Johnson and others, including those who, like Morris Johnson, had been imprisoned during the war for their political activities. But the key feature of this Congress was its political orientation. In many ways, one can see it influenced by Padmore's experience in Hamburg in 1930. It was a Congress which was the first Pan-African Congress other than the Hamburg Conference, which centered itself on the concerns of the masses of the people in the Congress, particularly workers and farmers. All the delegates in Manchester came from trade unions, workers' organizations, farmers' organizations, and so on. If we look at the slogans of the Congress, again we see the influence of the communist movement. Workers and oppressed peoples of all countries might be the most obvious one, but there are many others. In fact, in the extreme left-hand corner, can't see it very clearly, but there's a very famous quote from Karl Marx: "Labor in the white skin cannot emancipate itself, while labor in the black skin is enslaved." So this was the character of this Manchester Congress, known as the most famous of all the Pan-African Congresses, led by an ex-communist, but still influenced by his experiences, as well as by some of the politics of the international communist movement. Of course, it's worth saying that the Pan-Africanists of 1945 certainly took something from their experiences, as I mentioned, but they also reflected on them the wider experiences of the anti-colonial workers' movement. Of course, there have been major labor rebellions in the Caribbean in the 1930s. Just before the Manchester Congress, there was the general strike in Nigeria and so on. And there was every indication that just as the Comintern International Trade Union Committee, Negro workers and others had explained, that the working class, working people in general, were that great force which was going to transform the situation in the colonies. And that was embodied in the resolutions of the Manchester Congress. So I think that So I'm going to end my remarks there. Thank you for listening. If anyone has any questions, as was indicated, it's a book that took me about 10 years to write. There are quite a lot of pages. So I just tried to give a flavor, a sense of what was going on without burdening you with any details of it. So anyway, thanks for your attention. I'm happy to discuss or answer any queries.
Events this year.
So, although I'm maybe singling out Padmore, there was general kind of consensus as to what the times demanded. And I think the other feature of it is that that broad consensus is they work together irrespective of, you could say, political affiliation or ideology. So one of the key figures behind the scenes was David Barker, who was an African communist. One might thought would be at odds with Padmore, but they worked together on drafting various documents and so on. The other thing to be said is that many people were demanding that such a conference should be held. So I mentioned Amy Jakes Garvey. There were others in Britain who requested that there should be such a conference. As a kind of precursor to a much wider congress, which they envisaged would be held in Africa in a couple of years. So Amy Ashwood Garvey was kind of part of that mix, but I have no evidence of any particular role for her, specific role for her.
She talked a little more here. Padmore, of course, eventually wrote some very anti-communist things in his book. If I remember right, I read it years ago, I hope my memory isn't going. But communism, Marxism, Bolshevism, these are various strands in it, but there are quite a lot of differences in not seeing communism as a monolith, but also having different approaches to socialism, Marxism, Bolshevism, and so forth, that even came out within the Pan-African movement. CLR, for example, James and Padmore, you know, from the outset, CLR was so independent Marxist that he wasn't quite there, although he wasn't at the fifth conference, as far as I know. But could you tell me more about those internal activities within the communist, socialist, Bolshevik movement and some differences there? Because so far you have used communism as an overarching theme. Were there internal differences?
Well, obviously, in this period, the Communist International did exist. So the Communist International was essentially a party with local branches, and therefore it had its, you know, it had its congresses, which decided policy and so on and so forth, and then there was the implementation of that policy and so on. So in theory, it should have been monolithic in the sense that it had one political line and so on and so forth. Of course, in practice, it wasn't like that. And I mean, there are many illustrations of that, some of which I've already mentioned. So one illustration was that policy of the Communist International was that the organization of Africa, shall we say, was a key consideration, a key priority. But that didn't mean that anybody did it. So hence you have the criticisms of the British Party or the French Party or the US Party. Let's leave the US aside for a minute. The British Party and the French Party. I mean, the British Party did almost nothing for many, many years. And it was routinely criticized at the international level for not doing. So there was a, when we talk about differences, there was a difference between theory, the difference between what was agreed was a policy and the implementation of that policy. And of course those on the ground would have given all kinds of reasons why they couldn't organize effectively and so on and so forth. Then, of course, there were differences between individuals and the wider movement or local parties. And in the book, I go into great detail of the differences which Padmore had, for example. I mean, I can give numerous examples, but for example, Padmore was a as I said, secretary of the International Trade Union Committee. Okay. So then there was a decision that he shouldn't be the secretary anymore. He was going to be, he was told to return to his former work. In the same way that the same thing had been said to James Ford. Okay, you've been in Hamburg for 2 years, long time, on your own. You need to go back to the US and do something else. It's unhealthy to be there. So the same thing was said to Padma. Okay, we're reconstituting this committee, you need to return to the US. So he refused. He said, well, I'm not going. They said, you mean you're not going? He said, well, I'm not going. He said, you're trying to destroy this committee, blah, 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 blah. No, we're saying to you that there's this discussion, you should return. No, I won't. It's okay, well then you should come to Moscow and have a discussion. No, I won't do that one. So, I don't know how much you know about communist organization, political organization. It requires a certain amount of discipline. So if, as does any kind of organization, so if you're, there's an agreement, somebody will do something, they'll move somewhere. So anyway, he refused. So this is the kind of beginning of his separation. Then he's, as I said, he said, okay, well, Communist International is trying to liquidate this committee. Well, of course, it didn't liquidate it because there was a successor that carried on for another 3 or 4 or 5 years and so on. So then he, when he left, he wrote all these allegations of Communist International doing this. Then you have this whole thing about the Communist International is soft on Britain and France. And so everything starts to become justified by some other story. So there's actually no evidence for any of these things. But the issue about these differences and allegations, everybody repeats them. So if you read any book on Communist International, everybody repeats these same things as if they're fact, and they're not fact. And if you actually go into the documents, you can see exactly what happened. Then, you know, Padmore and Couillaté, was he worked also very closely with Couillaté in France, who was another, how shall I put it, person who exhibited a certain degree of individualism, individual initiative, which again is, say it's uncommunist, but you might say it's undemocratic. You can't just do something because you feel like doing it. So that's how they acted. And in Couillaté's case, he got all kinds of financial pattern. Nobody knew what was happening to it, even his own organization. So Couillaté was then called to report to his own organization, which was this Pan-African organization in front. Okay, so what's going on? So he refused. He said, no, I'm not going to appear before you.
But weren't there some problems people had with how they viewed the Soviet Union, which was
which
in vis-a-vis the African question? Or were these contrived? I know there were some conflicts.
Well, you see,
some of them thought the Soviet Union wasn't serious enough about that liberation.
But yeah, but who says this? Who?
I just want to know what I mean. You're trying to bring some things up.
Well, but people can say all sorts of things. But there has to be evidence of these things. So you were asking me, were there differences within the communist movement? So I'm just trying to explain.
Did Padmore ever, why did Padmore end up critiquing communism? When he was such an instrument?
He critiqued the communist movement. When he left, when he was expelled or resigned, he said, I leave. And I have no difference of principle. Mm-hmm. Okay. Then as soon as he left, he started attacking everybody. And saying, as I said, all the things that I've just said, embellishing them a bit more and so on. So, I mean, one can understand, you know, people leave, slightly leave a marriage, and then people start attacking you.
Did they have problems with the Ethiopian press there? The Ethiopian invasion, did they have any problem for the Soviet Union? Was not sufficient to support it?
Well, you have to read the book.
No, I read it. I read it. But
I've already said. No, I haven't, so I don't want to repeat it. I've already said that Okay, I'm going to, because I can see your, I need to whet your appetite. So yes. I'll give you an example. Okay. So Padmore said that the Soviet Union is not really sincere in its opposition to fascist Italy.
Yeah.
Okay. So, and what was, he said, why is this? Because the Soviet Union is selling oil to Italy. Okay. So, what are the actual facts? The fact is that the Soviet Union was, first of all, before I talk about the Soviet Union, let me talk about Britain and France first. Mm-hmm. Because the fascist invasion of Italy, we can say, was a consequence of the policies of Britain and France. In fact, Britain, France, and Italy had already divided Ethiopia 20 years before. But the invasion was a consequence of their appeasement policies. In fact, they went so far that it even led to the resignations of the foreign ministers of Britain and France, because it was such a scandal. So they facilitated this. Okay, which country was the most zealous opponent of fascist Italy in the League of Nations? It was the Soviet Union. The Soviet Union was the main supporter of sanctions against Italy. But it said that there's no point in having sanctions against Italy unless they're actually going to work. In order for them to work, in order for there to be oil sanctions against Italy, the major suppliers of oil to Italy need to be involved in those sanctions. The major supplier of oil to Italy was which country? The United States. The United States wasn't a member of the League of Nations. So if the League of Nations imposed sanctions on Italy, the US would still supply Italy more. So the Soviet Union said, well, there's no point in having sanctions. However, we will impose sanctions on Italy if every other oil producer within the League of Nations also applies those sanctions. Because they argued that their attempts to get the Soviet Union to make a sacrifice, which other countries are not prepared to make, and that will harm the economy and well-being of the Soviet Union. So they said, okay, we will impose sanctions, every other country does. But that, the other countries didn't agree. So some of you said, well, we can't impose sanctions alone. So then somebody like Pamela turns around and says, the Soviet Union is not sincere in its opposition. So this is it's kind of being economical with the truth about what was actually going on. If you read, I have a section in the book that goes into I look forward to your comments. But so these are illustrations, and there are probably some other examples of things that are repeated, and then everybody says, just as you said, this is the case, without actually investigating what the situation is. I mean, you may still come to the conclusion that you think the Soviet Union should have done more, or you think the US should have done more, or you think Britain should have done more, or whatever. But one has to look at the facts of the case. So that was an illustration. And again, if you look at the activities of the communist parties, I mean, they were extremely active on this question, including the Italian party, being very, very zealous indeed. So even whatever you think about the Soviet Union, of course, there's a whole issue about the link between the communist international Soviet Union and so on. So, but anyway, I go into some of these. That is not to say that everything was rosy, or that there's no criticism can be made and all these kinds of things. But at least we established the kind of basic facts, because there is no doubt that there's a kind of level of anti-communism, shall we say, around both that time and since, and particularly, in the Cold War period. So everything gets distorted, and everything is viewed in a certain way, or certainly in many ways it's presented. So it's good to go back and analyze these things.
Thanks for clarification. That's what I was seeking.
I mean, what is interesting, again, as I said about Padmore, is that he had these criticisms and so on, and yet in 1945 he wrote this book defending the Soviet Union and its way it dealt with the national question, national oppression, and so on. It's a very interesting book. If you haven't read it, have a look at what he says, because again, that's an area which encouraged many people to connect themselves with the Communist movement or to a defense of the Soviet Union during that period. I once came across a document from the 1940s from the Attlee's Labour government in Britain about the Soviet Union and how it had dealt with this issue of nations and nationalities. This was a cabinet meeting discussing the problem. But the problem for the Labour government, for the government, the British government, was that they said, well, everybody knows that the Soviet Union is dealing with these problems in a very enlightened way and solving these problems. And on the other hand, everybody knows that the British Empire is a kind of prison of nations where there's all this racism and national oppression. So what can we do about it? So they said, I know what we'll do. We'll have a propaganda campaign. We'll tell everybody that the Soviet Union is this, this, and this. And we'll go throughout the colonies. Try and find ways of broadcasting all this information. Then they thought, there were my people in the colonies, haven't got radios, how are we going to do it anyway? They developed a policy, or tried to, based on their view, the view of the British government, that the Soviet Union had made great strides forward and so on. So, anyway, the point I'm making is, at that time, there was this view, even by those governments which are in opposition to Soviet Union. So it's not surprising that people in the colonies also looked favorably on Soviet Union and the communist movement. And then the other thing is that the stance that the communist movement took on various questions. For example, on the question of colonialism. The communist movement was the only movement internationally that had an anti-colonial position from 1919 onwards. And not only had a view, but had a policy of what was required to end the colonialism. No other international movement had such a policy. And you can say similarly on racism and so on, which at that time they referred to as white chauvinism. So it had a policy on it in general and within the communist movement. And there are all sorts of famous incidents of people being put on trial for white chauvinist tendencies and so on. So I mentioned the example of the South African Communist Party, which was essentially a white party. The Communist International is happy to have a white party in Africa. It's not acceptable. Your policy needs to change. Africans need to leave that party, etc., etc. So these were the kind of principles which many people found very interesting and attractive. So, and of course, that leaves aside quite much, I think, I also have been referring to, of the general political analysis and orientation, which say communism as a body of ideas provides, how it analyzes the world and so on, which again many people were convinced by and took conviction from, not only in that period but in the post-war. If anything, the influence of communism was probably greater, if anything, more widespread, even though there was no international communist organization as such. But the post-war period is a lot more complicated. So. Okay, yeah, go ahead. There's a couple of them.
Immersed as you are, have been in the archive, it's provocative. given the amount of time that you've spent on to write this book, I have a question about the archives themselves for you, and that is to say, could you tell us how the study of the relationship between Pan-Africanism and Communism is situated, given what is classified and not classified in Britain, France, and Russia?
Well, I mean, the first point to make is that I'm mainly concerned with the Pan-Africanism of the communist movement rather than the wider Pan-African movement. Although, there are references to other organizations outside of the communist movement of necessity. I think that the archives are different types, put it that way. The Communist International archives are kind of enormous. You know, there's tens of thousands of documents in various languages. And there are kind of two types of documents, you could say. One type is kind of official pronouncements of various kinds, leaflets, statements of policy, and so on and so forth, which are very, very useful. And then there are kind of internal documents of meetings and discussions between activists and so on. So they give you different things. They're written internally. They're written by communists of various kinds. There are very often tensions between them. For example, the black communists generally who were organizing the International Trade Union Committee were always complaining that they had no resources. Steal or borrow to organize things and so on. So there are those kind of tensions, and also the tensions between the ITUC as a, which was put in a very difficult position of kind of working with and marching with local parties, and there's a tension between their activities and the activities of the parties. And so you very often get complaints that the German party is not being very helpful here, these kinds of things. So you get a sense of these kind of dynamics within the communist movement. The British and French material is different in that it's generally surveillance reports, secret service reports, police reports, phone taps, surveillance of one sort or another. In the case of the French material, it's agents, reports of agents within organizations. So you have to weigh up what people are saying. I mean, in some cases, you have more than one agent in an organization. So you might get different reports on the same meeting. One meeting, I remember, there were three people at the meeting and there were two reports, which was slightly different. So anyway, the point is, as with all sources, you have to weigh the different, there has to be some judgment. But let me one obvious example is, as I mentioned before, Padmore being arrested in Germany by the Nazis. So he, if you look at the internal reports, he writes back to his comrades in Moscow, who have been concerned about this. He said, no problem, everything's been secured, you know, nothing, it's all fine. And then you go to the British archives, where there's a report from MI5 or whoever it was, Special Branch, who are in touch with the Gestapo. They say, yeah, we've got like five trunks of material, we've confiscated, the Gestapo get a hand over to us and have to know that where it is, Hamburg, and it'll be on the ship, and they work very closely together and so on. And then, of course, MI5 haven't released most of those fire trucks, so we don't actually know everything, but we do know that Padmore was the economical truth in what he said. So, as with all sources, you have to kind of weigh up what is actually going on and try and construct something from it as best you can. And then there were some countries where I had very limited material. So there's a kind of section there on Cuba. I had some documents from the Comintern archives, not very much from Cuba. So that was kind of more difficult, so I had to be more circumspect. That's how I would answer that. It's trying to make sense and it's trying to present something. Obviously you can't say everything. And as I mentioned before, there are some voices missing because the archive is mainly male. The main organizers are male, not all male, but mainly male. There are some things I didn't put in, which one would be totally gender sensitive, you could say, I should have put in, but in telling the kind of big story that I was trying to tell, I didn't put it in. Anyway, so there are things like that, and then there are issues of people who just appear as shadows. Like Frieda Schiff is kind of a shadow, this Austrian woman who's obviously a key activist in Hamburg, Padmore, who's known as Padmore's wife. I don't know anything about her other than her name. And there are one or two other people like that. So I guess it's like writing any history that it's the best you can do given that within 10 years. If I had 20, I would do a better or worse job.
My question is on the changing demographic of Africans in Europe, particularly after World War II, the increasing number, the influx of students, and from the research, how it contributed to reframe the discourse of Pan-Africanism and communism, or Pan-Africanism or communism, in terms of where the commitment must be. So, yeah.
Okay. Well, obviously this book isn't about the post-war period, but I have written about the post-war period. And, there are two different, if I take Britain as an example, because I know Britain better than France. In Britain, two things happen after the war. One is that there are many more Africans. Obviously, there are more people from the Caribbean as well, but I'm more familiar with the African situation from a political perspective. There are more Africans, particularly West Africans, in the post-war period. And the second thing is that they're more militant. So 1945 is a kind of break. People are demanding an end to colonial rule. They're organizing in different ways. Even Nkrumah, when he was still in Britain, they organized immediately after the Manchester Congress, they organized the West African National Secretariat. They're communicating with their counterparts in France. There's talk about West African Soviet Union, all these kinds of ideas are around and so on. So in that period from the late 40s, many more Africans joined the Communist Party, the Communist Group. To the extent that later there's a West African branch in London, the Communist Party are trying to organize in West Africa, particularly in Nigeria, but to some extent in Gold Coast, Ghana. So there is that tendency. Of course, at the same time, the way we can call it decolonization works, the British government is also working overtime to thwart the communists, to isolate them, to make their activities illegal in the colonies, and to, you know, to create situations which make it more difficult for that politics in general to operate. So the government is very, very active in that period, the 40s and 50s, and they have their intelligence people all over West Africa. They're actively recruiting people to spy for them. They're setting up all kinds of organizations. In West Africa, I mean, they basically make being a communist illegal from the 1950s, which, I mean, Nkrumah's government also adopts this position. Nigeria is perhaps the best example, obviously, the way that independence was presented in this kind of regional way, and then you then have, you know, a fracturing of organizations, which all of which are very active in Britain. So the Action Group are active, NCNC are active, others are active. So there's all kinds of things going on. So yes, there's both more activity, more people, but also there are, I had a saying at that time, proletarian in London, bourgeois in Lagos. So in other words, a lot of people are drawn within the sphere of kind of communist politics without necessarily being consolidated or disciplined or reliable, shall we say. Anyway, that's the way I would explain it. But, I mean, there were some very interesting people who, I mean, had been communists for a long time. I mean, one of the most interesting is Desmond Buckle, because he was from Gold Coast. He joined the Communist Party in the late 1930s and was a communist for the rest of his life. He died in the 60s. And he was kind of influential in Britain, but also internationally to some extent. I don't think he ever returned to Ghana. So they're interesting figures, and that's a whole subject I'm about to return to, because it's so such a fascinating period, all kinds of things going on in that period. And the Pan-Africanism also flourishes, and in a way flourishes even more after the 58, particularly in Britain, because you have the development of the Committee of African Organizations, which is a really major coalition of all the African organizations in Britain, which develops throughout Europe, and it has its ties throughout Europe, it's organizing everything. Starts the anti-apartheid movement, invites Malcolm X to Britain, and all sort of fascinating stuff. So that'll be my next book.
Any more?
Yeah.
I'm going to read heresy. Because I can like heretics. And the first part of that heresy is that I am not a historian, which means that I'm not going to be that very organized and archived. But I'm going to the Padmore thing, actually. And as we were talking about Padmore, I was actually imagining, I was actually seeing somebody in front of me who is in this country, Randall Robinson, who created Trans-Africa here at this big US Congress around South Africa. And it was the same thing. A committed loyal constitutionalist who can lose his constitution, his rights to this place. In the country that pretends to be the defender of freedom and blah, 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 blah. And they tell him all the time, you know, these sanctions are not realistic. And I could actually really see Padmore and Randall Robinson, right? Saying it's about the principle. It's not whether it works or not. In fact, everybody else has voted that way. And I'm coming back to you, right?
that black people have always had these intellectual lives and have been drawn into cultural movement and etc. But the discipline thing is a party thing. And the communist Soviet Union does not actually control what communism means, if it means how one exists. And that there are imperial realities in which black people are involved, which actually makes me like Padmo Kouyaté, who is from Guinea. My father actually loved Kouyaté, and maybe that's my bias. Now at some point, and you can see Kouyaté, you can see Aimé Césaire, you can see a lot of people have a huge chance, you know, black people, you know, as Africa basically said, okay, we can be communist enough for you, we are going to have UGT, which is the Communist Labour Union, but the Laughing War and African War, right? Now, so what I want to plead for, and maybe I want to see you correct me, because I can say to my students, for instance, that the two things that really changed the language of decolonization before World War II were the Communist Revolution and the Ethiopian Italian invasion of Italy, right? The Soviet Union actually changed our attitude toward empire more profoundly than people may realize, because before the Soviet Union, you could not imagine decolonization without what they used to call the right to dispose of yourself, which means this controlled franchise thing, and basically the Soviet Union would imagine self-determination. But you can really accept that without it, we would not have seen that symbolically open this space, and yet be against this thing you call party discipline, because you are basically considered they control what communism becomes available as a language, nobody controls it. You are actually like heretics. If in fact you stick to the party, sometimes the party in Moscow can tell you, especially part of this period is the Stalin years, right? Which tells me that maybe heresy was actually a good thing to say that communism opens a space, and both the Soviet Union and these people are in contention about what that thing is. And they don't necessarily have the monopoly. So to say that the Pan War is wrong, for me, is like as a political theorist, I say, he may have had to understand vis-à-vis what communists should do in that context, and the party may be actually the problem here.
See, I mean, I think there's a sort of misconception. See, the Soviet Union is one thing. The communist movement is something else. Okay. So, as I explained before, the communist movement is one thing. The communist party in X is something else. But the principle is that, discuss something. Let us say we discuss something in this room. Okay. We agree we're going to do this. We're going to take over the university. Put it on the right track. Okay. So we've all agreed, maybe a couple of us don't agree, but the majority agree this is what we're going to do. So then the principle is, or the discipline is, then we have to do it. We can't say, okay, well, I didn't support that, so I'm not going to do it. The discipline is, the majority decide, and so on and so forth. So, a political party is, and particularly a revolutionary organization, is set up. It has to have that discipline. Because if we say we're going to go to the barricades tomorrow, and then everyone says overnight, well, maybe I don't feel like it, you can't organize anything. So you have to have that discipline. If you don't want that discipline, then you leave. You don't become a communist. You don't join a communist party. So that's fine. There's no problem there. The other thing is that the politics of the communist movement is also decided in that way. Everybody discusses, there are congresses, things are decided, and they have to be implemented. Of course, in fact, it didn't always work like that. There were differences, people didn't agree. I've given the example of the South African Communist Party. There were all kinds of disagreements about these things. But the process of arriving at decisions is based on these principles of what communists used to call democratic centralism and so on. So, the communist movement had a view on what should happen in any particular situation. That doesn't mean that other people don't have their views. And of course, Admiral or anybody else is perfectly entitled to their view, and there are you know, many instances where, as I've just given an example of Manchester Pan-African Conference, which was largely organized by Pan-African, you know, one can see, one can maintain that it was, you know, a very important conference and so on and so forth. He went on to have a whole other life and benefited from his experiences as a communist and from the principles of Marxism and so on, which he applied in his own particular way and so on and so forth. So, I mean, there's no contradiction between these two things. But as a communist, you have to operate in a certain way. So, again, if you are, you know, if we have this pot of money and you go and spend it, and then we say to you, well, you have to come and explain to us what you did with it, and you say, well, we're not going to, that is a problem. You can't operate. In any, even the university can't operate on that basis. So there has to be some decision-making process. So this was the main problem with Kouyaté and Patmore. It wasn't so much their views, their beliefs, and so on, which created difficulty. They had some differences and so on. But these issues of not being responsible to the organization you're a member of, This is, you can't operate on that basis. And then, of course, Kouyaté was expelled, and then there was also some suspicion about him because he was acting in this rather strange way and so on. So Padma was told, well, you shouldn't work with him because he's been expelled, we're not sure what's going on. So Padma said, well, I don't care, I've never worked with him. So that's not... If you want to do it, then fine. But as a person who is organized, even if you're in a trade union, I know in America people don't understand trade unions even. Even if you're in a union or any organization, you cannot just do what you want to do. You're in an organization. So you have to adhere by the principles of the organization. Otherwise you leave and do your own thing. So to me there's no contradiction. And you know, people often accuse me of attacking Padmore. I mean, I don't have any problem with Padmore. You know, I've written about Padmore, I think he's a great... But one has to actually look at, first of all, if there's a falsification of actual facts, then these things have to be explained and presented, at least in an accurate way. But of course, you know, Padmore's activity is, you know, is business. And as I say,
democracy was always a difficult thing for the party. And that the question of democracy, you keep going back to decision making, but the decision making actually requires a certain practice of democracy. Sure. And at that level, there were problems actually.
No, not really. No. There were only problems if, as I say, in these cases, people decide to do their own thing. Then that was the problem, and not consult with the collective. That was the issue. The issue of differences of opinion is not an issue amongst that period, amongst the communist movement. If you look at the congresses, everybody has a different opinion. That was the nature of communism. And you have to have the discipline in order to have the differences of opinion. You have to have a way of reconciling all these differences. Opinion, because when we discuss, like we discuss it, then we have different views. So how are we going to arrive at a decision? So the communist movement had its principles of how you arrive at decisions and implement them. But you read any of the communist documents, everybody's arguing about everything. Of course they were, because they're political people. So one person says let's do this, another says do that, that's the nature of the beast. So having a difference of opinion is not an issue.
The communist movement is the one directed by Moscow, Stalin. Is that what you're talking about? I
just want to clarify. We have this vast movement So you're telling me it's directed by one person. I mean, these are like fairy tales.
Can you define communism?
I defined it. One of the first slides I showed you, I defined it.
But did you even...
I defined it. What do you want to say to me? You didn't like my definition, so you want me to redefine it.
Well, there are many Marxist axiologians who rejected going with the Communist International and so forth, why they had suspicions about it. That's what I'm saying.
So what's your point?
So weren't there different ideas speaking about the Stalin, the Communist Party?
I'm talking about the Communist International.
Right.
I'm not talking about some person called C.R. James.
Okay.
I'm not talking about individual people. Yeah, that's why on the cover of the book I make it clear for people what I'm talking about. I put it in big letters. So nobody can be confused.
Okay.
Who can read English?
I understand.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Basic democratic principles. What do you call
can't organize anything.
You can do what you want. I still don't know.
Thank you.